worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior. How is a bhikkhu moderating eating? While reflecting rationally, he eats food neither for the sake of entertainment, nor of infatuation, nor wishing for bodily beauty, but exclusively for the support and maintenance of this body, for ending discomfort, and for assisting this noble life, considering, thus will I now end this old feeling of hunger, yet without arousing any new feeling of greed. Thus will I remain healthy, blameless, and in comfort, exactly as one treats an open wound, only for the purpose of healing it, or as one greases an axle only for the sake of easy transport of a heavy load. So does a bhikkhu who is moderated in eating while always reflecting rationally eat food. Thank you.
Hello to you again, friends. Just a short afternoon walk and talk on central core concepts, philosophies, and practices within Buddhist meditation. And one of them is, of course, contemplation of death, which is the problem for all beings who are born. So this Marana Anusati is something that couples up with considering aging, sickness, and death, this process. And this is a topic today. Usually it is something that people shrink from because they fear death. They know they're gonna die and they will be old, but they don't like to consider it. And therefore they shrink back and do not get the full benefit, therefore, of considering it thoroughly and completely, repetitively and frequently. So this is what we will do today. Of course, one often, especially as young, is caught up in complacency. One doesn't think much about it. One is buzzing around with all kinds of other very tantalizing subjects. A friend of mine recently admitted that until he was 17 years old, then he seriously considered death only to be a problem for others, not for himself. Now he's a medical doctor in his late 50s, just as I am. And of course, he has come to grips with this fact. Why is it advantageous to see aging, sickness, and death? Because it's a way to realize suffering, dukkha. That dukkha is inherent in all existence. Because of this impermanence that leads to aging, sickness, and death. There's two ways of considering, two time planes, or two time scales, you can say. One can consider this aging, sickness, and death. One is the aging, sickness, and death of the very moment. That the moment arises and ceases, so each moment dies right there and can never be recalled again. And the same thing with the body. It grows up, becomes older, and then dies. This is the two extreme scales, Then there's the middle case, either any situation, the youth, or the beauty, or the good meal, or whatever kind of satisfaction there is. Then this also follows this pattern of aging, sickness, and death. You could say sickness we can transform into the word decay. And then any state in life, any period in life, any situation in life, in any life, will always undergo these three stages of aging, decay, and then death, vanishing, ceasing. And when one realizes that to the full extent, then suffering is easy to see, is evident. It's right there in front of one, that this process is inescapable. It cannot be avoided or repaired by any kind of doctoring or all kinds of other tricks. There's no voodoo that can repair aging, sickness, and death. Huh? Not the case. So this presents one with the only solution, actually. This is to escape the cause of death. And what is the cause of death? Usually people say it's accidents or drug use or cardiac arrest or whatever. But deep down, the cause of death is, of course, birth. One has to be born. It's an ultimate requirement, indispensable necessity to die. It is first to be born. And this man presents the solution right there at the very front. Because if one is not born, then one cannot die. Death is impossible to the unborn, the uncreated, the unconditioned being or existence. What is the unborn, the uncreated, the unconstructed, and the unconditioned dimension of being? That is Nibbana. Nibbana is not impermanent. Why so? Because it's not temporal. It has no beginning and no end. It doesn't begin, and therefore it doesn't end. It's not spatial. So it doesn't have a body that can decay. So this means that this solution to this ever-recurring problem of aging, sickness, and death, the only solution is to achieve the state of Nibbana. Neither more nor less. So is it, and so have it always been. The closer one comes to the realization of that fact, that is the only solution. First seeing, not denying, neglecting, or running around in complacency or naive infantile fantasies, like I can be forever young using plastic surgery and Botox injections and various hormones. Not doing that, taking the bull by the horns, and then see, there is this aging, sickness, and death is inevitable, inescapable for everybody. Even Buddhas, even Devas, all have to die. When you've been born, whether spontaneously born without mother and father as the Devas, or born with a mother and father as us and the animals, we all have to die anyway and go to another state according to our karma, where this problem rearises again in every life and also in every moment and every period, that there is this arising, decaying, season. Aging, sickness, and death. Of the moment, of the life, of the being. All the time, again and again, again and again, again and again. And now we come to the hydropower. Now I have to screw down because there's a lack of water here today. You can hear it makes funny sounds. My homegrown hydropower. I'm very proud of it. So over and out from another point. So how is this contemplation of aging, sickness and death done? You know, whenever there is a possibility that it's seeing other persons that is aging, seeing old people, hearing about old people, hearing about people who have come to the hospital, seeing dying patients, seeing corpses, whether from animal or from human, then one says like this, also, this body also, this process of being also, will undergo the exact same destiny. It cannot escape it. It's unavoidable, this aging, sickness and death. It cannot be escaped. And this then gradually makes one realize that this process of being is suffering. It's not something that only Buddhists say, that it really is so. And then one starts, this starts one's path of turning away from what is suffering, namely life in samsara. Turning away from what is suffering produces relief, because this long standing clinging, maybe snake, clinging to form, clinging to this body, this frame, clinging to feeling, pleasant feeling, and even painful feeling, clinging to perception, all kinds of sights and experiences, clinging to mental constructions, all kinds of hoping, plans of activities one will do in the future, or have done habitually in the past, and clinging to consciousness itself. This clinging, because it's now, it is identified as suffering, and rightly so. Then one stops clinging to that. Then, to this extent, that happens. Fearlessness of death is induced. And fearlessness of death implies, per se, functionally, fearlessness of all other things also. Because death is the worst catastrophe there is for all living beings. And this means that if the being is fearless of death, then they are also fearless of all other things. And this fearlessness lifts mind out of a long-standing, often unseen, subconscious suppression caused by fear of death. Because death is uncertain. In most cases, not all, but in most cases, people don't know when they are going to die. Because of that, of course, and they know they are going to die, and it could happen tomorrow and the next second, then this raises a kind of long-standing panic, agitation in the mind. Because maybe I die tomorrow. Maybe I die in the next moment. Maybe I die in a disease next year. Or so on and so on. Huh? So this agitation keeps turning. And as long as this agitation keeps turning, then of course there cannot be any happiness in the mind that is agitated by panic and fear. This excludes happiness to arise. So fearlessness of death thereby takes away that mental suppression there is from this panic and fear of death. The temple of the forest monk, very nice place, small waterfall, huge ferns, stone and moss. No priest, no bells, no incense sticks, only nature. Well, back to the fearlessness. Yes, the fearlessness is a nugget of gold, because then whatever circumstance there come, whatever adversity, shock, perturbation of one's life quality, and they come by the bundles here and there, every day and every year and every month. The grass one of is called loss of job, health, loss of money, divorce, loss of lover, loss of friendships. But they come in all sizes and colors and strength. But all of them, they suddenly appear as small, insignificant details. Because the fear of death has vanished. And then the fear of these minor things, much less severe than death. Well, these fears, these anxieties, they evaporate too. So this means that this practice of considering aging, sickness and death often, repeatedly, systematically, by gripping any chance to it, it produces fearlessness and thereby lack of panic and anxiety, and thereby increased well-being and joy because of fearlessness. Fearlessness. A golden state, a precious pearl in the state or in the long row of results from Buddhist training. However, the Dhamma only pays on or pays off to the amount it is practiced. Talking about it and reading it, and so like this, intellectual understanding is not enough. It's only theory, pariyatti. It has to be practiced, patipatti. When practiced over a long period, then suddenly there comes penetration, breakthrough to fearlessness, pativeda. And that is an irreversible state. Had you first reached fearlessness of death, then you never fear it again. Never, ever, ever. It will alter one's behavior in many senses. One become more stoic, not taking more chances, not more cynical, just more stoic, more dwelling in equanimity, the state of neither sadness nor gladness, neither pleasure nor pain, but just peace of mind, equanimity, upekkha, also a golden state. And the Buddhist pearl string of results of training. And then we are back under the cypress tree, and I will say thank you for your attention, clever consideration, and advantageous support, and may you have a nice day, life, and faring on in samsara. See you again later down the road.
You heard Bhikkhu Sammahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy, thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution and have a nice day.